Hi, it's Ponyo here. I thought that I would film a little video to make it easier for you to see how my workflow is. I apologize, I'm a little sick, but not too sick that I can't do this, so we're gonna film it anyways. It's not necessarily the newest way or the best way to edit images or to have your workflow, but it's the way that I've kind of developed or got into myself. So I just thought I would show you how I would have my workflow, and then you can adapt from there. And if you want to change anything, then definitely I suggest trying different things as well to figure out which way works best for you. So let's get into it. So I always start with Lightroom Classic, not just regular Lightroom, because that's actually different. I always start with Lightroom Classic. That's actually the one that's a little bit better, at least for me personally. I just find it a bit more intuitive, and I don't really need the cloud part of Lightroom, and it has less options. So I kind of prefer sticking to this one. So if you sign up for the photography package for Adobe, you get Lightroom, Lightroom Classic, and you also get Photoshop. And I think it's 20 bucks a month, something like that. I can't remember, but something like that. So I always start with loading up Lightroom, and then I would plug in my SD card. Well, not my SD card, because it's actually a CF Express card. I don't use SD anymore, unless it's just a backup for my camera, because it does dual slots. But anyways, I would plug in my card, which I'll do right now. And then this will pop up, but this is for my computer. This isn't for Lightroom. I'll just exit that. So in Lightroom, if a dialog doesn't automatically pop up, you can go to Help and then go to, or start pressing import, and then click import photos and videos. And then you'll see that I have just like random stuff on my card right now, and that's just for the video purposes. I didn't want to use someone else's photos because I know some people aren't comfortable with that. So I thought that maybe I would just pick my own photos and edit that. So I'm just going to deselect some of these that are not important. So I've got, you can see on the side here, I've got my Macintosh HD, this is my external hard drive, the T7 Shield, and then this is my memory card. So I've selected all of those. I typically will rename the files, so I could rename this Ponyo I shoot, because this was initially for like a Halloween shoot. That's why it looks kind of creepy. In fact, I've already got the final edit in that on my card because I just loaded them on. But anyways, so I actually always load on my files to my external hard drive now. So I'm going to put them in RAW, and I wouldn't put it in clients for this instance. I would do collabs, and then create a new folder if I want to, just by right-clicking it, and then name it what you want. Me! And then press OK. And then down here you can see import, and I'm gonna import all of those pictures on my SD card, in this case, but usually it'll be my CF Express card. And then you'll see the progress it's making. And here we go. So you can see that they're all uploaded. And so if we want to edit one of these, let's say, well, actually first I'll show you how to favorite your images. Now there's a couple different ways of doing it. You can star them, so you can press between 1 and 5 on your keyboard. So if you can do 5, or you can just do 1 or 0. But I always just press B, and what that does is it saves it to your quick collection. And I'll show you that in a second. So let's say I press B on this one. You can see there's a little tiny icon that appears right in the top right of the photo. Then let's say I choose this one, because this ended up being the final image. And so I've favorited 2 pictures, and they will appear up here in Quick Collection, right here. and you'll see that they're right there. This is a photo I just did of Bianca. She looks beautiful, but we're not focusing on that today. We're gonna focus on this one. So what I would do is I would not really do anything in Lightroom at this point. I would export the photo and edit in Photoshop. So I'm gonna do that right now. I'm gonna right click the image, edit in Adobe Photoshop 2024. Lovely. Okay, so we got our photograph here. You can see my hair is a mess because it wasn't actually, like, this was just a test image. I was gonna have a mask on my face anyways. But let's say I did want this image. The first thing that I usually do is retouch the skin. And I'm gonna add a link to an action for frequency separation, which is what I'm gonna be showing you here. It's not my action. Where did I get this one? I can't remember who I got it from, but I'll link them in the description below. But anyways, it gives you these two actions right here. Basically, an action is something where if you click it, it does it automatically either applies certain settings to the layers. Basically, it just does things automatically for you and just increases the efficiency of your flow. So I'll show you in this case what this one would do. So what we need to figure out first for this, though, we need to figure out what bit this picture is. So if you look in the name of the picture right here, you can see it says RGB 16. So we know it's 16. And so we're gonna press frequency separation 16-bit, not 18-bit. Now before I do that, I'm gonna show you something that I always do every time I open up a file, and that is duplicate the first layer. And to do that, at least on my computer, I may have changed some of the quick keys, so I apologize if it's not correct, but Command J, and I've got the original layer duplicate it, just in case, because I don't like to make permanent edits that I can't go back on. And so after I've done that, now I can go to frequency separation 16-bit. And basically for this, it's going to bring up a Gaussian blur. You want it to be so that you don't really see any texture. So let's try, I usually go 8 or 10 pixels. I think I'm going to go 10 on this one and press OK. And now it has actually separated the basically color layer, I'll say it like that, and the texture layer. So this is what it would look like if it's just the texture layer, which is the high frequency. I'll rename that texture for you. And then just basic color. There's probably a better term for that, but I like to keep it simple for my brain. Texture and then color, and then together they make the image. And you want them to be separated because it's actually more realistic to edit certain parts of the photos, like the texture, separately from the color, because you don't want to affect the texture too much in certain areas, and you don't want to affect the color too much in certain areas. The reason you need the color layer and this texture layer separate is because you can't really blur just the skin and have the texture look proper. You need to separate the color so that you can blur that and keep the texture. And I'll show you what I mean by that. So right now, I'm gonna go onto the color layer, and I'm going to make sure I've got my lasso tool at feather 10. You don't want it to be a clean cut. You want there to be a bit of a feathering to your selection. So I'm gonna select this area right here, just roughly. And then my command for this I actually made, so I'm not going to use what I would normally do. But you go to filter, blur, Gaussian blur, same kind of idea. So you would want to blur the color together for a more even skin tone. So you can kind of play around with that and select different areas. Now I actually have it so that I can press Command F to apply the last filter that I used. So in this case, I'm just going to be doing that constantly. So I do Command F, I it kind of blurs the color together a bit more. Command F, you can press it more than once in an area as well. Command F a couple times. Get some of that shadow in there, try to blur that out a bit. Now it doesn't have to be perfect because we're also going to paint as well. Just trying to soften it a bit here. Lovely. Now if we were doing that with the texture, then the texture would just be blurred, and we don't want that. We want the texture on our skin. We don't want to look unnatural. Now let's see. I'm actually going to switch to the stamp tool, and I'm going to go on my texture layer. Now I want to get rid of this piece of hair right there. So I'm going to sample an area of texture right here and click. So you press Option on a Mac, and that changes the thing, the little icon. So I'm going to hold Option, and I'm going to click a different area of texture that I like and let go. And then I'm just going to click and drag where I want to put that texture. Now you might need to click another spot to grab another area of texture, because you don't want it to look too repetitive. You want it to look natural. If you use the same piece of texture for the entire strand, then it just might look like it's obviously cloned. So I'm just going to work that to get some of the hair away, or some of the little dots right here. And you can use that on little pimples. And you can use the clone stamp tool like I'm using, or you can also use the patch tool. The patch, I somehow cut myself in my sleep using my finger, so that's what this is right here. But I'm going to select that using my patch tool, drag it to a different area of texture that I prefer, and let go. And it will apply that texture to that spot. But for now, I actually prefer using the clone stamp. But make sure, the thing is, you got to make sure you deselect this, because if I start editing over here, nothing's going to happen because this is the area that's selected. So I need to press Command D to make sure I'm able to edit anywhere in the photo. Select some texture, apply it there. Select some texture, apply it there. Same idea for the entire image. And now let's see. Let's try color. Sorry, I'm getting into editing. See, there's a bunch of color in there. I got rid of some texture, but it's mostly color there. And that's okay. We can go to our color layer, click it and drag it, and then bam, evens out the skin tone. If I didn't want the dimple in my chin, I could probably select that, select a different area, and it blends it in. Not perfectly, I'd want to paint in there a bit more, but, and by the way, Command Z is undo, there we go, and Command D is deselect, don't forget. So now for painting, I actually like to paint on a separate layer in between these two layers, just in case I do too much painting, I go too far, it looks fake, and I need to tone back a bit more. So you can't really see up the top, but I'm going to select layer, and at the top it says new, and then you're going to click layer on your screen, and then just put a layer right in between. And then now we're going to select a paintbrush, probably change it to be a bit bigger, make sure the hardness is very low, and make sure your opacity is low too, because you don't want to be suddenly painting a whole bunch of dense color. So we're going to want to lower our opacity maybe to 14. Now I'm going to select some color that I want to paint. Let's select some of this. What I did is press Option on Mac, and then I paint where I want to put that color. I'm going to click and let go, click and let go. Every time you click and let go, that'll apply another layer of paint. And if you want to see how far you've gone, you can press this eyeball tool, go like that. Pretty cool. If you want to see all of it, press the eyeball tool for the whole grouping, just like that. And so let's make our paintbrush a little bit bigger. Keep sampling. It's always good to keep sampling colors from different areas because you want it to look consistent and natural. Blend it in. If you don't like it, press Command Z. Lovely. some red in there that I don't like, so I might just go like this, bring that, and just move that around, and there we go. Let's do some more texture. Gonna grab my clone stamp tool, always have that at 100%, sample, and then apply, sample, apply, sample, apply, and continue. Here's some specks on my lips. Lovely. Now I'm going way too into this. Do as much as you want. And if you even just want to soften the texture, but don't want to necessarily sample an entire area, grab your clone stamp tool and change the opacity to like 50% or something. Sample somewhere else and then apply that. And that's only going to apply a little bit of the texture, which kind of blurs it, but not too much. It just is basically adding a different texture on top of another texture, and it just softens it. So sometimes I might do that on certain areas if I have rough skin or whomever I'm editing does, just to soften it a little bit. Bam! So I'm trying not to get too picky. But anyways, so that's how you would do like retouching skin. Obviously that wouldn't be a finished one, but that gives you an idea. And then so after that, I would be doing what's called dodging and burning, basically brightening and darkening certain areas of the image. And to do that, I'm going to create an adjustment layer, and I'm going to create a curves layer. And for this curves layer, we're going to make it the dodge layer, so brightening. And just brighten it whatever you want, doesn't really matter at this point. Dodge, which is brighten. Just saying I can't use clone on that, which is true. I didn't mean to. And so for this, this is where you learn where painting white shows this particular layer that you're on, and painting in black hides wherever you're painting. So right now you can see that this piece of paper looking thing is completely white, which means this whole adjustment is showing. But if I invert it, Command I, it's completely black. So none of that adjustment is showing. So now I can choose where I want it to show. So what I'm going to do is use my paintbrush, opacity maybe 14, sure, make sure you're painting in white on that piece of paper. And then I'm going to maybe brighten up a little bit here, some highlight. See, that's a bit too much in my opinion right there, but I liked it there. Let's zoom in. I'm going to make my paintbrush a bit smaller. You can brighten the eyes if you want. I like doing the waterline sometimes. Brighten the highlight. A little bit of the iris, you can see my contacts, and just brighten where you want to brighten. That was too much. Thank goodness for undo. It's better to start on a lower opacity than a higher one, because they tend to not go as far. I always like doing the little Cupid's bow as well. Some people like to have the nose done, just a little bit of a highlight here. And you can even do things like highlighting the hair, and that can make it look more pretty and shiny. Hello? Oh, it's Finn. Hi, Finn. Finley. Hi, buddy. Hi, sweetie. Finn's here. Hi, buddy. Oh, it's my sister's dog. Hi, Finley. Hi. And where was I? Okay, so now we're gonna burn. We're gonna add a burn layer. Again, we're gonna add curves. And then we're gonna put the curves down. We're gonna lower the exposure because we wanna darken certain areas of the image. But you can see it's completely white. And we need to invert that so that's nothing. And now we want to choose where we want to darken or burn areas of the image. So some people might want to do the cheeks if they want to add a bit more contour. They might want it on the cheeks, and you can always do this to see the before and after. Nice. And you might want to do it along the lash line. I usually like to go there. Burning, I might go a little bit more intense, so I might raise my opacity. Always check to see where you're at. And then same idea. And you could do the same thing with the hair if you really want those curls to be defined, or if you want the hair to look a certain way. Bam! And then you can see. I didn't realize my camera was filming in 4K, so it needed a few minutes to cool off. Now that we're back up, I can go back to the picture and see where we left off. Let me just make sure my phone's still recording. I had like a bowl of soup and everything in between. Okay, here we go. And so I think we're going to save the image basically, but let's just see the before and after. So if you're just wanting to show one specific layer and take away all of these layers from being visible, you're just going to press, I think it's Option, and then click the eyeball. There we go. Bam. Before. After. And then I'll make more videos, if it's helpful, if you'd like me to, just showing how I would maybe sharpen certain areas in Photoshop, maybe even like liquify certain areas of the body. Or if you want to see how I might Photoshop an AI background into an image, whatever you think you might like to know. But for now, I'm just gonna leave it as simple as that, and we're just gonna save. And to save, you press Command S, and it should save in the same area that your original is existing. Nice. And look it, it's popping up right beside the original in Lightroom. And so we can see the original file right here, and you can see that says CR3, which is a raw file for Canon, and then right beside it you can see the TIFF file, which is the Photoshop edit. So we got the raw, and then we got the Photoshop. And then from here, what I might do, or will often do, is do my color editing, or what some people may say like filters and stuff like that. So to do that, I would go to Develop. And you can see all of these sliders on the side here. We got curves, so I won't go so fast, but maybe next time I'll go more in depth about it. But you've got your sliders, exposure, contrast, highlights, saturation, that kind of thing. You can play with your colors if you want to change them. And then a lot more stuff as well. There's sharpening, what sharpens the entire image, or if you want to add a vignette. There's a lot in here. I've got kind of presets that I've made and saved that already have specific settings. So basically a filter or something that's automatic that applies the settings on the side panel here. So if I've finished editing a shoot in Photoshop, I might first go through my edits in the side panel to see what of my previous presets that I have, presets actually the proper word for it, that I might want to apply to the set after tweaking a bit. So I can see that I kind of like the way that looks. It might be maybe a bit too moody. I don't know, I like mood, but it depends on what you're feeling. But if you press the forward slash, you can see the before and you can see the after. So I do like the way that that looks. And then if you did have more images that you wanted to apply that preset to, you press copy, or Command Copy, Command C for Mac. I'm sorry, I don't know PC. And then choose the settings that you would want to copy, mostly all of them, except you wouldn't want like brushes or blemish removal to be copied if you had been doing that in Lightroom, because then that will copy it to the other images, but it won't actually be in the same spots and it'll look like a mess. But anyways, you want to be careful of what you copy if you have done stuff like that. So copy. Go to the image you'd want to copy it to, press Command V. Obviously this one's already edited and finished, but then that would be how you apply that to other images. And then the last step that I would do, if I wanted to export all my images, all that set, I would press Command A, because typically I'll have all of that set in my quick collection. Command A selects it all, or you can press Command and just select the ones that you want to export. Right click it, export, and then export. And then you're going to choose where you want to export it. I'll just choose desktop for now. Choose that, rename it if you want. The other thing I will do is I'll export a large file size and a small file size for web, because it uploads better on social media. For small file sizes, I usually do 4 megs at 200. That's probably all you need to know for now. And then export. And then it will export those 3 files to the spot on your desktop. And then you can upload them wherever you want. And yeah, that is pretty much it. Let me know if there's any other specifics that you need me to go into. And like I said, I can go into other kind of edits as well. And that's it. You have a good day. Bye.